This is Ham Radio Now, episode 300, the big 300, part two. You know, there was going to be a part two, but it turns out there is. Because, you know, in part one, we never actually got on the road. And I forgot something in part one. It was pretty important. Well, I didn't really forget it. What happened was, there's a little record button on here. It's a toggle. You push it once, it starts recording. You push it another time, and it stops. And I'm not the only one who's done this. You get out of sync, and at some point you either forget to stop or you don't actually get started, and then the next few times you start and stop, you think you're starting and you stop, and you think you stopped and you started up again. So all the footage you've got is when you're pushing the camera around and getting it where you want it to be, and then just as soon as you're going to shoot what you want, the recorded video stops. And what I missed was the mount, the most critical thing of the mobile installation, the thing that holds up all the radios. So let me show you what that is real quick, and then we'll get on the road. Oh, cool. There's their logo. It is a RAM mount, and it starts here in the passenger footwell with this base plate that is securely bolted to the seat bolts on both sides. Then it's got this mast, there we go, it's a lot of clutter in here. It's got this mast that heads on up to an articulated arm. It's got a couple of points where you can adjust it, and that holds the computer. Right now I don't have the computer up there, I've got the mixer sitting on there, but that's the computer tray. And also coming off of the top, can you really see it there? You see this, that's the tightening adjustment, is another ball and socket arrangement. It's kind of buried behind all the wires. And then there's a plate, and that's the back of the plate right here, that has all the control panels on it. And then the two radios that don't have remote control heads are on the top. I think I talk about that during the on the road episode. There's just a angle bracket that holds a mobile mounting bracket. It's got those pieces on it. And you know, the wiring is not so neat from the back. I said that, you know, just kind of added things over and over again. There's a powered speaker. It's actually a DSP speaker. I had it when I was using the 706. 706 DSP wasn't very good, and this was better. The 7000 has got IF DSP, so I don't use this for DSP, just for being a speaker. And this hose has most of the wiring in it. This is just temporary for plugging the phone into the mixer. The hose had most of the wiring in it, but things got added on top, as usual. I mean, I'm not the cleanest installer. A lot of these wires are the temporary audio for the shoot. But anyway, that's the backside and that's the mount. So that's how everything holds itself up. And as I said, it's a whole lot prettier if you're looking at it from the driver's side. In fact, that's pretty darn ugly. A ham did that. Okay, let's get back on the road. I think I'm going to talk about that 20 meter contact with Australia that I didn't make.
Hello. All the radios are making noise. No, I didn't work that guy in Australia. Talk about that in a minute. Hang on a second. Okay, Google, navigate to Orlando HamCation.
Actually, there's no address for Orlando HamCation.
Navigate to Orlando Fairgrounds. No. Navigate to Orlando County Fairgrounds. That's
okay,
wrong, too.
Central Florida Fair.
There we go.
Here we go.
All right, it's smarter than I am. I'm not actually going all the way there today. If it were, it would take about 9 hours. But it's 11:22 a.m.
You should reach your destination by 8:10 p.m.
No. I got other stuff to do. But I don't know where I'm going to stop tonight. So we'll see.
Mobile stations only, please. Call now.
Alpha, Quebec.
I heard Alpha, Quebec. I know there were others. Call again, please.
This is South Cars, 7251.
I had a good bit of doubling in there, and then I heard Romeo Foxtrot. The others, please spread them out. Mobiles only.
Regular viewers know that it's not a trip until I've checked into one of the mobile service nets, East Cars, Mid Cars, or South Cars in this case.
Alpha Quebec Mobile, you're up first, come in.
Good morning. It's Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec. My name is Gary. Located currently in Cary, North Carolina. That's just outside of Raleigh, North Carolina. Destination today, well, the destination eventually is Orlando, Florida, heading down to the Orlando HamCation. Not sure how far I'm going to make it today, but I'm not planning on going all the way. Probably someplace around Savannah, maybe Jacksonville. It is a beautiful 60 degrees, cloud-free sky. An absolutely gorgeous day in eastern North Carolina. Back to next. Oh, my South Car's number is 1872, 1872. Back to net control, KN4AQ Mobile.
Hey, Gary, you're like me. You got one of them low numbers. Gary, in Cary, North Carolina, is pointed toward the Mouse House. Gary, stop in Savannah. It's prettier than Jacksonville. 60 degrees and the sun is shining. $18.72. Kilowatt November 4 Alpha Quebec in the mobile drive. Careful, Gary. Lots of loose nuts when you get down in Florida.
I've been there and I've seen them, and yeah, I'm proud of that number I got here. I don't know how I did that. Evidently, I checked in once when I was a young child. 73, I'll be listening and being entertained by you guys. KN4AQ Mobile.
Next up, I got Romeo Foxtrot Mobile. Good morning. Need to relay.
Yeah, I'm not hearing Romeo Foxtrot. Okay, so it's an official trip. We're on the road. Checked into South Cars. That was easy. That was quick and easy. Okay, so no, I didn't work that guy in Australia. I was setting the equipment up. I just turned the camera on. And bang, there he was. Was that on 20 meters? I think it was 20 meters. And I have worked Australia from the mobile before. But never with a signal like that. And he was S9, super strong signal. And almost nobody else on the band. That was weird. Didn't turn my turn signal on. Must be. I'm not concentrating on my driving. So you may have noticed, I think you can see there's no computer over here. I sacrificed that spot for the mixer. Makes it a lot easier. I'm hearing more alternator whine. Is it all from the mic? Pretty much. You know, when I'm editing the programs and listening on speakers, I pretty much never hear it. But if I'm listening on headphones, if you're listening on headphones, you might be able to hear it. Well, I think I got everything. There's very little left at the house. So I think I've got everything I'm supposed to have. I hope so. We'll find out. This is a familiar part of the trip for you guys, because this is the same route that I took to get to St. Petersburg for the DCC last September. So, the stuff out the window is not going to be that exciting. Unless some weird traffic happens. My wife, Cindy, KD4ECW, has a dash cam always running in her car. And we were down in Charlotte. You may have seen this on Facebook. I don't think I put it on the Ham Radio Now group on Facebook, but I put it on my personal page. And it wasn't downtown Charlotte, it was the south side, you know, suburban type environment, major road, 5-lane wide. And we're not super paying attention, you know, she's driving and just ordinary paying attention. And then, you know, ahead of us, there's this car that suddenly veers across from the oncoming lanes. It's a few hundred feet ahead of us, so we weren't in jeopardy, and there was another car in front of us, and that kind of obscured part of what happened. And then it just crashes, T-bones straight into a car that was two cars ahead of us. Just smacks it, pushes it off the side of the road. And you know, we're trying to remember what happened. I'm calling 911. Check out that the woman driving the car is okay, and she had a young child in the back, secured very well in a child seat. So Cindy got in the back and is comforting the child. And I'm talking to the woman, making sure she's okay, calling 911, getting fire trucks and ambulances on the way. And then we go look at the dash cam and see what really happened. And the oncoming car had pulled all the way to the right-hand lane. And there was a car, it's a turn lane, a right turn lane. And there was a car sitting still in that right turn lane waiting for a pedestrian to cross the street. And it looked like the guy that did the crash realized that car was stopped at the last minute. And you could see him jerk to the left, but then, I don't know if he lost control. Whatever happened, he crossed all those lanes and then T-boned into the car that was coming the other direction, the one that was two cars in front of us. So that's what we could see on the dash cam, and it was interesting how different that was from both of our memories. Neither one of us remembered it quite that way, and neither one of us remembered that there was a car in front of us partially obscuring what happened. It wasn't obscuring the T-bone, that was clear. Just kind of obscured why, but a little bit of the middle. Crossed and we could see everything where he jerked away from crashing into the car that was stopped, and then he crossed the car in front of us, and then over into the right, our right-hand lane, into the T-boning into that car. You could see both of those. I think maybe that car in front of us actually pulled into the left turn lane, got out of the way entirely, I think. And now my memory is foggy. So the moral of this story is, if you think you remember something that you witnessed but weren't specifically paying attention to, maybe you did and maybe you didn't see it. A lot of people have ended up on death row based on somebody's eyewitness testimony. It's a little scary. No, I'm not turning there. I always often turn here and rarely take the direction that I'm going. So my car wants to make this right-hand turn. So let me talk about not calling a DX station who's in an ongoing conversation. I think almost every ham who's been around for a while understands this as a concept. not a good idea to break in. I mean, here's somebody in a country that you want to make the contact, and they're in conversation, or to put it in ham terms, they're in a QSO. Don't use ham terms that much. So you want to talk to them. What would the harm be in just breaking in? And, you know, let me just get you in the log here and we'll get your QSL card. Well, it's one of those things that if one guy does it, you know, that wouldn't be so bad. But it's not going to be just one guy. And listen to what happens when the guy calls CQ. He gets a pileup. Even Australia will get a pileup. Australia's not that rare. Make it a bit more rare and, you know, be a huge pileup that gets spotted on the cluster and there'll be 10, 20, 30 people deep trying to call him. So that's what would happen if you could just break in and make your contact and the guy's trying to have a conversation. He never would. So have the conversation and then maybe he'll call CQ at the end or stand by for anybody who's listening. And it may be a 2-minute conversation and it may be a 30-minute conversation. You don't know. You might be able to read it if you're listening to the contact a little bit. So that's why I didn't call him. He did eventually end that contact. I couldn't hear any of the other people that he was talking to. And he picked up with someone else right away. And I was getting the radios and video and all that stuff set up, so I didn't stop to try to work him. So if you're a new ham, you get that itch to work that guy. You know where he is. You know his call sign. You got all his information standing by. You looked him up on QRZ. You got the log halfway filled out. All you got to do is put in the time and the signal report. And I'll just break in and give him a quick call. Won't interrupt his contact very long. Don't do it. For one thing, he probably won't answer you. And if he's serious about it, he'll mark your call down and he'll never answer you. So, episode 300. Tell you what, I made myself some... actually made myself some notes here. It's an interesting time for episode 300. Because episode 1, and I'm on the way to Orlando, to the HamCation, episode 1 was 5 years ago on Friday, 2 days from now. Today is Wednesday. Episode 1, 5 years ago, standing in front of the gate at Orlando. So I'm not going to wait to reproduce that in order to produce this episode. My goal is to actually edit most of it tonight. And I'm not sure that I'll do on the road tomorrow or not. Once I get to Orlando, things are going to get pretty busy. So I may try to wrap this all up today and edit it tonight, get it online. It's part of the reason why I'm not going to drive all the way to Orlando. Although if I did, I'd have all day tomorrow. Well, we'll see. We'll see how I feel as I get to about Savannah. 5 years ago today. 5 years ago on Friday. 300 episodes. Something that I haven't mentioned on a show, but I have mentioned on the Facebook page, is that maybe a month or so ago, we crossed another milestone. 1 million YouTube views. 1 million views. Yeah. Well, okay, that's kind of not a big deal. It took almost 5 years and almost 300 shows to get to the number of views that your average 13-year-old putting up a cat video will get in 2 weeks. So, you know, I put that in perspective. But I was at a local podcasters meeting. There's a meetup of local podcasters. I'm the only one that's doing a ham radio show. The other guys do a variety of programs, financial program, some storytellers. There's a guy who does a show on professional, well, not professional, but competitive shooting. Marketing, a lot of business-oriented stuff. And I'm the only one doing ham radio. But when I introduced myself, you know, go around the table. There was about 20, 25 people there. Go around the table, everybody says who they are. Most of us know most of the others, but there's always somebody new. And so you get to say a little bit about what you're doing. And so I say, you know, Gary Pierce. I don't give my call sign. That would confuse people. I do the podcast called Ham Radio Now. It's, guess what? It's about ham radio. And I've got something I'm really proud of. I just crossed 1 million views on YouTube, and everybody cheers. You know, and I know, and I think they know, that that's not really so much of a thing. And then I checked with Randy Hall, K7AGE, because he congratulated me on the million views. Randy's been doing YouTube a little longer than I have. And I asked him how many YouTube views his channel has gathered. He was like 3.5 million. So I'm catching up. I remember when I first started, he had like about 6,000 or 7,000 subscribers. I've also now got almost 10,000 subscribers on YouTube. It's another useless number because not nearly all of them watch most episodes. You know, they click the subscribe button, but they don't get notified. They don't come by. Every once in a while, maybe you do. And Randy, I don't know what his subscriber count is, but it's way, way above that now. So, yay, 1 million views and almost 10,000 subscribers. Where'd my keep page go? Some of you, many of you know that I have started doing audio, serious audio podcast version of the show. It's literally ripped from the video. I don't do anything special. Once in a while, I will cut out a half a second or a second of the silence at the beginning. The silence at the beginning of the show is mostly for YouTube, because depending on how you watch your YouTube, YouTube doesn't clear their screen clutter for about 3 seconds or so. I'm not going to wait that long. The show will begin while there's still some screen clutter on things like Roku and Chromecast. But for the audio folks, that would be, you know, 3 seconds of silence. And that's like, what happened to the show? Yeah, there's some people whose attention span isn't that long. So if I remember, I will cut that out. But I don't always remember. But starting about April last year, I signed up with a subscription service. Yeah, I don't want to be in this lane, the emergency. Oh, no, I did want to be in that lane. That was my exit. Yeah. I went the wrong way. Talking and not paying. I mean, I'm paying enough attention that I'm driving, but not to where I am. And of course, I left the map. So this isn't as bad as what I did on the way to St. Petersburg when I spent the night in Savannah. And first thing the next morning, got on the road on I-95 going northbound. I was supposed to do going southbound. This isn't that bad, but it's pretty stupid. I'll have to go a few miles up the road to get to an exit. Some of it is a little confusing because, as you can see, maybe you can see, this is a very construction-oriented place. There's, or they call them Jersey barriers up every place. They've been rebuilding that highway for a couple of years now. They call it, the Department of Transportation, somebody there had a sense of humor, and they asked people to put a name on the project. Said, name name the project. And the name that was most popular and the most clever was Crawley, C-R-A-W-L-E-I-G-H, because traffic was going to come to a crawl in Raleigh. Okay, you get it now. And so they announced that was going to be, that was what it was going to be. And then somebody who had less of a sense of humor, but a higher position on the pay grade scale at the Department of Transportation said, no, we're not going to call it that. So I forget what they actually called it, but bureaucrats, higher you are, the less of a sense of humor you're going to have. Because, you know, everyone's going to be mad at the traffic, and so you don't want to remind them there's bad traffic by calling it Crawley. Where was I? Audio. So, leave the map up and just go remind me once in a while what's on the Google Keep reminders. There's only a couple of those there. So the audio thing. I subscribed to an audio service called Libsyn. It's where a lot of podcasters go. There's two or three main services. What they do is they provide the online storage space for your files and easy, simple connections to things like iTunes and other places that don't actually store files but provide the database, the avenue for you, the viewer and listener, to look up on a podcast app on your phone or iTunes, if you're an Apple guy, and find all these millions and millions and millions of podcasts, including now, Ham Radio Now. I've never been listed like that before. So just the audio, but it makes it easy to download, and you can catch the program. Okay, let's see if I can figure out how to get on the road the right way. Not too bad. A detour. Okay, well, there's the sign. I do want to go to Benson, Wilmington, 1 mile. I'm in an exit-only lane. That should keep me safe. So I did that so that you could download the audio. And in the world of people who make both video and audio, and a big part of that world and the beginning of that world for me was the folks at Twit, audio is usually way, way, way more popular than video. So if a show gets 1,000 video downloads, it might get 3,000 or 4,000 or 5,000 audio downloads. And especially the long form shows like this one that go on for a long time. It's kind of easy to understand why. Most people have more time to listen to something than they do to watch it. So once again, if you're one of those people that has only ever watched Ham Radio Now and said, gosh, I wish I could get a whole show, but I can't sit in front of whatever consuming device I'm sitting in front of and watch this whole thing, and for some reason you've missed the idea that an audio podcast is available, well, it is. So you want to find out more about it, if you've got a podcast app, just type in Ham Radio Now. I think it works as one word. It certainly works as three words. But if somehow that's not working, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, and I want to make sure I'm on the right road here. hamradionow.tv, and I think it's the tab says audio. The link is actually RSS, but I think the tab says audio. I'll explain how to get set up. If for some reason you need to put a manual address into your podcast app to be able to find us. And then you'll be the first person to get an episode of Ham Radio Now, because I put the audio out often 30 minutes to an hour before the video goes out, sometimes 6 or 12 hours, because if I'm finishing up something late at night and it's either rendering on the video or slowly uploading to YouTube, although YouTube uploads aren't that slow. I've got a 24 megabit upload speed, and an hour-long show usually goes up in about 30 minutes, but sometimes, usually YouTube takes another 30 or 40 minutes or an hour to crunch the program into the files they're going to actually distribute on the web. So, while all that is happening, I get the audio done, and do websites and YouTube or Facebook and stuff. If you're ever Johnny on the Spot on Facebook, and I've posted a link to the video, it's because YouTube, but it won't play. It's because YouTube gives me a link to the video where it's going to be, but if it hasn't fully rendered yet, they're still processing it, it will give you a blank screen. It'll give some kind of error message. Sometimes it will say, well, we're just waiting for this to get all done. And sometimes it will say, I don't know, it's just not here. I don't know. So that happens if you are, I don't know if you can see that tower up there. It is loaded. It's not one of the big 2,000 footers. We're in the neighborhood of our 2,000 foot towers. I can see the tip of one of them off to the left. That one's got about four tiers of cell and two-way stuff on it. So, if you're real quick to try to play the video as I've announced it on YouTube, on Facebook, then you might get that blank screen. And something should appear within 15 or 30 minutes, or sooner, depending on how quickly you caught on to it. The initial run. The other places that I announce real quick are the Patreon page, which reminds me, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Arvin is once again not with me on this trip. Oh, somebody said something yesterday on the air, and a viewer of the show, I was talking to him on DMR system, and he said something about feeding Arvin, which, you know, I like, but I won't talk about that on the radio, because it's business on AM radio. Those are three 2,000-foot towers. They're off to the left of the highway. I think you might be able to see them. I'd point the car over that way, but I'd crash into this guy who's passing me. And as we make this bend, that's your last opportunity to see them. There's a half a dozen or more ham repeaters on those towers, mostly all on one tower. All on one tower. So the guy said he was going to feed Arvin, and that brought into my mind, yeah, Arvin is starvin' Arvin. So yeah, stop by hamradionow.tv. Head on to the bottom of the homepage or look under the menu that says contribute and take care of Starvin' Arvin. You ever wondered where Arvin's name comes from? Well, if you look at my lower third super, or if you ever get to the very end of the program, you'll see a great big splash screen that says ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News. And that's the terrible name that I came up with for naming the podcast, for naming the service before we were a podcast, before we were a YouTube show, for naming the service that I made DVDs. My goal was to make documentary style programs, edit them, put them out on DVDs, sell them, and the name of the company was going to be Amateur Radio Video News, and the first website was arvidnews.com, because I thought, yeah, everybody makes abbreviations when they do websites. But arvidnews.com was not memorable. And I realized that no one understood that, so I changed it to arvideonews.com, and that still wasn't very good. I thought about arvn.com, but that's not available because of that Army of the Republic of Vietnam thing. No, they don't have the .com. It's just in one of those warehouses that wants thousands of dollars for it. But then I got arvn.tv. That made sense. Took that clue from Twit. There was twit.tv. So let me see if I can wind my way back in this conversation to where I started from. That's where ARVN, that's why he's called Arvin. Because, you know, I never said Arvin. I always said ARVN. But everybody who referred to it to me said Arvin. And okay, it's Arvin. And then when we came up with the mascot, obviously his name was going to be Arvin. So there we go. That's why he's Arvin. I just hang on to the amateur radio video news thing. As you know, I call it like the parent company of ham radio now. It's nothing like that. It's just another name. Makes us look bigger than we are. Let's see. 19 miles to my next turn, so I've got a ways to go. 19 miles until I miss the next turn. So hamradionow.tv and click Arvin, and you can help out with the Patreon thing I was talking about, which is monthly, and they collected the first couple days of the month. This is sounding familiar. I think I may have talked about this when I was showing you the car. Yeah, I'm pretty sure I did, except for the Arvin part. So anyway, winding back further, because people have put money into Patreon, I'll let those people know. Patreon has a post or an announcement function, because that's the whole idea of Patreon. It's for people creating things, and then once you've got people subscribing to them, you want to let them know, and you make an announcement on Patreon. So that is, I get the audio up first so they can get it, and then I make the announcement on Patreon, and then I go to Facebook and Twitter, and then finally QRZ.com. If you subscribe on YouTube, you can set YouTube up to notify you. A few programs that I subscribe to on YouTube will pop up a notification on my phone when a new episode comes up. So I'm not sure how to tell you how to do that, but I think you dig around a little bit in YouTube, you'll find out how. And I think I could wind my way back another step, but I'm not sure where I came from here. I guess the audio podcast. You can get it. It's available. And some of the if you're familiar at all with the show, and you probably are, especially if you've gotten into it this far, you know that we do a lot of talking head shows, and they're good for audio. Do some documentary type stuff in the field, and they're not very good for audio. And some things like we'll be doing at Orlando, we've got some forums to record along with Jason from the Ham Radio 2.0 show. And they're 50-50. It sort of depends. If the person has a lot of slides, and all the slides are is text, and they're basically reading the slide, or the slides are headlines for them speaking extemporaneously, then you don't really need the slides, and the audio is fine. But if the slides have pictures and charts and graphs, most of them drawn too small for you to be able to read, then yeah, you kind of miss the point. Could be hard to follow if you're just listening. And I try to rate those things. If you've looked at the text that I put up along with the audio podcast, toward the end or sometimes in the middle or beginning, I'll put up what I call the radio rating. It's a A through F scale. I don't think I've given anything worse than a C minus or maybe a D. The very, very most visual programs will get a C or a D. I haven't come across something that you get nothing out of. I guess that would be no sound at all, just picture. I won't bother to put that up as audio, but that would be an F. And a typical talking head show will be an A. And this, I'm not sure what I would do with this, because I've done some on-the-road shows that were really pretty, going through the mountains of West Virginia, even the plains in the Midwest, and of course the going across the mountains out west. You get some really gorgeous scenery. Here, and for most of this trip down to Orlando, you're just going to be in a green canyon. Wall of trees on the right, wall of trees on the left. A few spots you'll see some farms, and a few spots you'll see an edge of a city. But there's really not that much to see. The radio sitting here. Be about it. Occurs to me I forgot to face them forward. I don't know what the camera's seeing out of them, but usually they're a little bit too dark to see much of anyway. So this will probably get a pretty good radio rating. Just me babbling. And eventually turning on the radio and talking on it. Eventually. Sooner or later that's going to happen. I got the DVAP running. I think it's still connected. Part of the reason why I'm late this morning is programming all these radios took forever. And then I discovered I didn't have... the computer is sitting down there. It's sitting on the seat. It's not doing any mapping for me. I'm letting the phone do all that. But it's running the DVAP software. Go just unlinked. So I don't know why it unlinked. Maybe it ran out of cell coverage. But that gives me the opportunity to tell it to link again to 54C, the North Carolina reflector. Do a echo test on that, see how it sounds. KN4AQ testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
KN4AQ testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
So once again, I've got the 7000 ported directly into the mixer. And for the VHF radios, VHF, UHF radios, I've just got a microphone back there. Get some road sound. There won't be much road sound when the radios are talking loud enough. They'll overcome most of it, but I'll leave that off most of the time. But what the heck? KN4AQ Mobile, south of Raleigh, on the road on I-40, heading toward Orlando, listening Reflector 54 Charlie. What I was finally winding up with on this audio thing is that most podcasts that began as video and have audio, or they do both audio and video, the audio is way ahead. For me, the video has always been way ahead until just the past few episodes, and they've been good audio episodes. But even the good audio episodes, if I get 2,000 or 3,000 video views, I'd get 300 or 400 audio downloads. And the past few have reversed. Still not getting thousands of audio downloads. I think the biggest one is still just over 1,000. But the in the week or so that the past three or four episodes have been accumulating views on YouTube, they are in the 300 or 400 range. They'll eventually maybe reach 1,000. They should do more, but I put out so many, I've been so prolific for the past 6 weeks or so that people are having trouble finding time, I guess, to watch the shows. But the audio downloads have exceeded the video views by a few hundred for each program. So if a show has got 300 video views, it's got 400 or 500 audio downloads. So we're finally maybe turning that corner, getting more people to pay attention to the audio. So yay. So at the beginning of the show, I answered many viewers' requests and gave you a tour of the Q-mobile, such as it is. Yes, it is relatively elaborate. It all works pretty well. It is not as pretty as it seems from my vantage point, from your vantage point, just looking at the stack of control heads. It's been a little prettier. Things grew. Wires got laid on top of wires. That's the way things go. I'm not the neatest installer. In fact, I'm pretty darn surprised I ever got the ambition to put all this together. And so I made a note that I should talk about the history of the Q-mobile. I bought the RAV4 back in 2007. I described this as, it's now almost 10 years old. In March, it'll be 10 years old. And we are sitting at 159,398 miles. It's almost 160,000 miles. It's been a great car. It's still, I'm not going to say it feels new, but it feels tight. It doesn't squeak. There's been very little mechanical wrong with it. So I'm pretty darn impressed. And the car had good reliability ratings when I bought it. It's part of the reason why I chose that. This is the first SUV-ish car I've had. Back in the 70s, I had a few of what was very popular back then, hatchbacks. This is kind of like one of those hatchbacks. The rear seats will fold down and create some more flat space. It's not a hatchback, it's a side-opening door. I guess it's still a hatch. It's bigger than those cars. I think it was a Plymouth Horizon is what I had. I like the form factor. This is, you know, not a sports car. Well, SUV, I guess, has got the word sport. You know, a sport utility vehicle. I don't know about the sport part. But it was about the right size. Got halfway decent mileage. Not as good a mileage as the car that preceded it. That was a Buick Park Avenue. The only reason I ever had that is it was my dad's car, and he passed away, and my stepmom drove it for a while. She wanted to get a new car, and offered the Park Avenue at a good price, so I bought that. It's about the time I needed a new car, new-ish car. It only had 25,000 miles on it. So loaded it up with a fair number of radios. I had a dual bander, probably. I know I started with a standard. Standard made a dual bander, a really high quality and very expensive dual bander. Standard didn't stay in the ham radio market very much longer. They'd been in the ham radio market. They started back in the 70s with a handy talkie and maybe a couple of mobiles. And they kind of dithered in and out of the ham radio market over the years, but that was their exit from the market when they made that radio. And in fact, it was a tri-band radio, 6 meters, 2 meters, 70 centimeters. And the most bulletproof, let's make a noise, most bulletproof intermod immune receiver that I'd ever seen in a radio that was capable of broad reception. It would do way outside of 6 meters, way outside of 2 meters, way outside of 70 centimeters, and I believe it did 800 megahertz. And even today, you'll hear lots of hams say, if you got a barn door receiver, you're going to get a lot of interbaud. If you've got a barn door receiver that's not designed to reject it with good on-the-fly tuning, then yeah, you'll get a lot of intermod. But that radio rejected intermod better than anything I'd seen except for a Motorola receiver that had what they call a PermaK filter, a very a big chunk of metal tuned filters, cavities in the front end, and that kept just about everything out. So this radio wasn't that good, but it was pretty darn good. Yaesu bought Standard, and then they came out with this FT8900, and it was apparently based on the Standard's design, because this receiver is also pretty bulletproof, pretty intermod resistant. And the programming is not very Yaesu-like. I've attempted to program some Yaesu handy talkies, and I didn't get very far. And I've reviewed a couple of Yaesu radios. Well, the radio I reviewed was, I think, the 7900, which is the 2 meter only version of this, and they're programmed similar to this. But other Yaesu radio line mobiles and handhelds are totally different. So this one programmed more like the Standard did. It's been a long time since I've played with the Standard. I've had two of them, and one of them died. And the other one's just kind of out of service, gathering dust on a shelf, because it's pretty long in the tooth, didn't have as many memories. So this radio's receiver also impressed me as being very intermod resistant. And then I've had the opportunity to be in some very high intermod areas, including downtown Chicago, right in the Loop, where there's a high concentration of high power broadcast and two-way stuff on every band. And the 2820, the ICOM 2820, was pretty useless. I could hear the downtown repeaters. The S meter just went up to the top and stayed there no matter what. I couldn't hear any repeaters 5 or 10 miles out of the downtown area. And there's a lot of frequencies that had pager noise and the double audio of two intermod signals. So that receiver was pretty useless. The Yaesu receiver wasn't totally immune to everything, but I could hear the distant repeaters 30, 40 miles away just fine. I'm going to remember to make this turn onto Interstate 95. Yay. Yeah, 95 South, Benson, Fayetteville. That's where I want to go. I'll give a hat tip to the Benson Hamfest. Johnston Amateur Radio Society. It's in November. It's a small hamfest. You won't be traveling from very far out of town to get there unless you're a vendor and you want to sell something. But it's just down the road from where I am now. And I don't think I made it last year. So, downtown Chicago, the Yaesu did well, the ICOM did not. You can have a barn door receiver that does a decent job of projecting intermod. Maybe not perfect, but a decent job. Winding the story back to the Q-mobile. So, in that Park Avenue, I had the a 706. I don't think I hadn't acquired the 7000 yet, because the 706 was the first HF radio in this car too. In fact, it was the 706 original, and then it was upgraded to a 706 Mark IIG. And that might have happened in the Park Avenue, and that might have happened in the RAV4. I don't remember. And also a 220 radio. I don't think it was this 220 radio. I think it was an ICOM 38, 37, 38A. You see them sitting behind my head when I do a studio show now. So I have those three radios in there. And I don't really remember the fever dreams that I had of building up this mobile installation. And like I said, it's impressive to look at. A lot of people look at it and, you know, go, wow. But I've seen people build impressive mobile installations where they put everything in a console. They had a bigger vehicle. They had empty space between the two front seats, you know, something like a Tahoe. They had plenty of empty space between the seats, and they could build a console and put all the radios in it, make everything real neat and tidy. And I knew that in the RAV4 I wasn't going to be able to do that, so I started looking for what for what would fit. And pardon me, I got to wet the whistle. I've been talking a lot. Not beaconing. The APRS radio is not coming on. I think I must have, in showing you stuff, I must have bumped the power connector for it. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to get to it. Everything is so full up back there. That's sad. I like beaconing APRS, but mostly I like monitoring 5.2. I guess I'll put this radio over on 5.2. Now where was I? The fever dream. Again, I don't remember the specifics of it, why I thought this was the way I wanted to go. But I did. I'm also not scanning DMR. It's all the prime stuff here. In the wrong zone. Here we go. I was so excited to get on the road, I forgot to do all the basic stuff. And I should be demonstrating radios instead of just monologuing, but you've actually seen most of that before. Can't see the DMR radio down here very well. I can't see it very well. KN4AQ Mobile, southbound I-95 on PRN Sanford. It's a good distance away. I don't know how well I'm making it. In a little while, I'm going to whine about how long I spent programming DMR repeaters down in Florida, and I still didn't get done. I'll still have to do more tonight before I get to Orlando. I'm enjoying DMR, but there are many pains in the ass to it. Okay, nobody's answering. Put the microphone back. So in any case, I had some fever dream about doing this, and I started doing some research. I knew most of the radios were going to be remote control head radios, so the radios could go under the seat. But how was I going to get them control heads up here where I could see them? That's what I wanted to be able to do. And I'm not sure where I came across the idea of the RAM mounts. I'd had a public safety type mount in the RAV4, in the Park Avenue, that held the 706, the Yaesu, and the 220 radio, the ICOM 38A. So I've become familiar with the idea that, you know, the mounts that they make for the police cars are probably the way to go. Like, I probably just did a Google search. Came across this company called RAM, R-A-M, and you saw the video of all the pieces. Very modular, but starting with the base of the thing that mounted to the seat bolts, and they have one for almost every vehicle out there. You might not find one for that Alfa Romeo that they advertised in the Super Bowl, but almost everyone out there. And they had one for this, and it came with the base, the pedestal, the mast, and then the arm that goes out, and a variety of ways to hold the computer. So I got that, and then putting other pieces together, there's a plate. I don't know how well I showed it. There's a vertical plate about 11 inches long that's behind this, and all these mount to it. Yeah, there's somebody there on PRN, but he is breaking up a little bit, and I'm pretty good distance from that repeater, and that's the closest repeater to me, I believe. There is one that we have better coverage over here, but it's been off the air for a while. KN4AQ Mobile on Southern Pines PRN. Am I into the PRN from this repeater? It's back. I don't know how well it's hearing me. I was talking to the guy who maintains it, and finals failed. KN4AQ Mobile, listening PRN on the Southern Pines PRN radio. So he replaced that module, and I guess I got back down there. And
unit done, and I think you're on the frame, so it's
yep, I'm on the fringe, that's what he said. So, there's one more I could try. Nope, not making that one either. And suddenly traffic is too heavy to spend much time diddling with radios. I would change zones and pick up a South Carolina repeater that I might be closer to. But all of a sudden, traffic is heavy. We need to get out of this lane. Okay, he's going to go fast enough. I don't need to get in front of him. Draft for a minute. Okay, now I can change zones. Tone that comes on indicates I'm not getting a signal back to the repeater. I'm planning on doing a show on programming these TYT radios. I've learned a lot about it. When I had them in operation for the trip to Orlando or to St. Petersburg for the DCC, it was brand new. I am far from an expert, but I know a whole lot more than I did back then, including being able to build these things called code plugs, which is nothing more than just ordinary repeater programming. ordinary in different than ordinary in that from an analog radio, you program the frequency, the offset, the tone. For DMR, you got to add a lot of other stuff. For D-Star, you got to add a lot of other stuff. So the code plug, you know, that's just a clever thing to call it. I don't know if that, I guess it probably originated with the commercial side of radio programming for DMR. I don't know. Didn't turn on 220. Just noticed on the scanner that it stopped on the Raleigh 220 repeater, which I'm rapidly pulling away from, but it's still pegging the meter. I don't have a microphone over by its speaker, so you're not going to hear it very well. I do have this radio set to be able to listen to some 220 frequencies, but can't transmit there. It's a little weird. Okay, now where was I? Somewhere around the RAM mount thing. So the antenna controller, the 7000, the 8900, this isn't a front panel, it's just a small box, so it easily mounts here, and it's, in fact, it's on Velcro, I can pull it off. So the 7000, the 8900, and the 2820 are all front panels, and they're mounting just to a flat 11-inch tall plate that's connected by a series of ball and socket arms. But these two things don't have the front panels, they're not remotable, so I mounted just a pair of L brackets, standard hardware L brackets, and then a mounting bracket on top of that for this radio, and then some Velcroed strips to hold the 220 radio on top of it. It's total kludge, but it works. That's some of the Velcro that is starting to fail, though. So I just need to take it off, clean it up. Getting the old glue off is a little bit hard, but I think some glue gun should help. Ooh, do I want to take the time to go up on top of Pedro? Maybe. Certainly not going to get chased off by a thunderstorm this time. Yeah, let's do that. On top of the sombrero, if you watched very deep into the trip to, I keep wanting to say Orlando, it's St. Petersburg for the DCC. Tried hard to go up and see the sombrero, and both coming and going, there were thunderstorms. Definitely no thunderstorms today. So I should be able to go do that. Yay. It'll be something to see. Stop complaining that I'm not doing any radio stuff. I talked on the South Cars net. I'll try to work some DX later. So I had that fever dream. I looked at the RAM mounts. I put all the pieces together, and this is what you see. And it is now about 10 years old. And I've been having fun with it. Most of my actual on-the-air operating is while I'm driving. Now, these days, I don't have a daily commute. I'm mostly retired, and most of the work that I do is at home, doing this podcast and a few other things. Occasionally, I still get a call from a client that'll take me on a 20 or 30-minute drive. And I'll talk on the VHF stuff or the DMR, but not really worth doing HF. So, okay, I'll turn it up. Okay, you heard. All right, let's do a propagation check. I'm going to send the antenna down to the bottom. You can hear WWB at 10 megahertz, at 15 megahertz, at not at 20. What you're hearing right now on 20 is the antenna controller. When I turn it off, the signal will go away. And now underneath it, you can hear a little bit of WWE. And nothing on 25. Okay. So most of my operation is mobile, and I really like these long trips because it gives me the opportunity to talk into a podcast and occasionally work a little radio. I'm still connected on 54C.
DD access point dongle.
Yeah, still linked. Hasn't dropped off. So I think I was winding around something else, and now I really don't remember what it was. Well, the history of the mobile. I think that's pretty much it. This car is not showing any signs of giving up the ghost. It's probably got at least two or three more years with me, and maybe quite a bit longer. We'll see. I'd say at least 200,000 miles and maybe longer. These cars can go that long. It hasn't needed much maintenance. I make sure the oil gets changed on schedule. It doesn't have a lot of other scheduled maintenance. 100,000 miles between radiator flushes. That's pretty cool. Not very much other lubrication to do, so I get done what needs to get done. Sooner or later, some things will fail. Pumps and motors, alternators. And I remember when I was growing up, a car with 20,000 miles on it was an old car. I had cars that I would trade in at 30, 35, 40,000 miles. I mean, they were giving up at that point. So it's pretty amazing. And I don't know how the car companies stay in business now, selling cars that last over 10 years and over 150, 200,000 miles. Apparently they do. Maybe you get over the 10-year hump or so, and now you've got the same cycle of cars aging out and being bought new. That math isn't working in my head somehow. I don't know how I came up with that. I'm actually going to turn the air conditioning on. It's only 70 degrees outside, but the greenhouse effect through the front window is pretty pronounced. So I'm getting pretty toasty in here. So I had the windows open a little bit to draw air through the vents. But now we'll let it actually cool things down. Yes, 70 degrees. We're in North Carolina. We're not in Florida yet. So I remember from episode one doing the tour, standing out there in my shirt sleeves, telling people how beautiful it was in Florida in February. And I know that there's folks around the rest of the country and elsewhere in the Northern Hemisphere that are in the throes of deep winter. And here in February in North Carolina, I could easily be driving through 6 inches of snow. This is not normal February weather. Not complaining, but it's not normal. And it's going to be in the 80s down in Orlando. And the last forecast I saw was for totally sunny blue skies. It's going to be some of the best weather Orlando has had, except indoors it may be a little bit toasty. They do have air conditioning. It's Florida, after all. And it's not like the air conditioning at the old Hera Arena, where they cranked it up all overnight as hard as they could. And when the vendors came in the morning, it was like 60 degrees. But by the time the crowds came in, by 10 o'clock, it was uncomfortably warm. So I don't know what I'm going to do for the next vehicle. One thing I didn't mention about the history of this car is what paid for it. I'd started to sell DVDs and stuff, but they weren't really making me any money. In 2007, I was freelancing at an ad agency that has a little audio studio in Durham. And it's not a local account agency. They have national accounts. And at the time, they had Audi and a few other national accounts. And accounts come and go at every agency. They've had big accounts come and go. They had Royal Caribbean. Trying to remember some of the others. They did Nationwide for a long time. They don't have Nationwide anymore. They lost a couple of big accounts lately, and they've been suffering some. They're still doing okay, but they're not at their peak. But at that time, they had Travelocity, and they were into the second year of the Travelocity account. They invented the roaming gnome. And when you watch my studio shoots, you'll see a couple of those little roaming gnomes behind me. And the reason they're there is that when I started freelancing for them doing audio, early on in that endeavor, they were casting for a new announcer voice for a new series of commercials they were pitching to Travelocity. They had the gnome, and the voice of the gnome was a British comedian. His name is Harry Enfield. He's in the vein of Monty Python, a couple other relatively famous British television personality comedians. But he was not very well known over here. And he's a genius, brilliant guy. He'd just crack us all up all the time when we were recording him. He wouldn't come to America to record. We recorded him. He was in a London studio, and we recorded him over a digital phone line system called ISDN, the original, I think, digital phone service. Still around, still in use. Gives, I think, 128 kilobit per second digital audio signal, which is good enough for a full bandwidth mono audio signal. It sounds great in low latency. So we would record his parts. And they had done a year's worth of him doing commercials, mostly television commercials. I guess they did some radio. And they were going to change the nature of the account, of the campaign. They're coming up with a new campaign. They were going to call him the Denouncer of Travel Myths. And the campaign, the idea of the campaign was he would announce a myth, you know, something usually kind of ridiculous, and then debunk the myth and prove how Travelocity got you around whatever the problem was that you thought there was with travel. And the very first commercial was American appliances don't work in Europe, because of course Europe is 220 volts, we're 110, or we're 120, they're 240. These days almost everything you plug in will do both, and do it automatically. And the only problem you have is the actual connector. You need an adapter of some kind. But for a long time, if you tried to plug a hairdryer or something into a European power outlet, you put it through an adapter, but your hair dryer was only designed for 120 volts. You'd burn it up. So the comedy there was American appliances don't work in Europe. The roaming gnome says, that's nonsense. Of course they do. And he plugs one in and he blows himself up. So they had his part recorded. They needed an announcer to come and do their part. And they were casting for it. They had a series of people come by and try to read for what the producers thought they wanted. And they weren't really getting it. They weren't really happy with what they were hearing. And I had done a little bit of not professional announcing for them. You know, I'd done some radio stuff myself. But not for them, but I'd done some scratch tracks. They knew what my voice sounded like in recording. And they said, well, give it a try. Let's see. I didn't even say, how about me? How about me? Me. They said, Gary, would you like to try? I think they were kind of running out of ideas. And I knew what they wanted from what they've been describing. I've said this a few times. It's somewhere between the Ted Baxter from the old Mary Tyler Moore show and Movie Tone News, both a very stilted professional delivery. That's my Walter Cronkite. A very stilted professional delivery. I don't do a very good Cronkite. I do a really good Casey Kasem. That's my one impression, and I really nail it. Our long-distance dedication goes out to a ham who wants to make a DX contact with Australia, and he just can't wait until the Australian station has finished his QSO. So he tries to break in, and the Australian station ignores him. And that's our long-distance dedication. All right, so this is what I did. Travelocity presents The Roaming Gnome, Denouncer of Travel Myths. And they loved it. And they sent it to Travelocity, and they loved it. And I thought, okay, cool, I get a TV commercial. It's going to pay $1,000 or so. That turned into 8 television commercials and about 30 or 40 radio commercials over the course of 2.5 years. And I bought this car, all the radio equipment, and the installation, and a relatively fat 401k, which this was 2008, and then the real estate crash happened, turning the 401k into the 200 and a half k. And some of the editing equipment. So, cool. That money is gone, by the way. The 401, the 201K is still there, and it's working on building its way back up. It's not awesome. You know, it's not retirement. Cindy is my retirement. Cindy and Social Security. But it's there. I'll use it in a few years to supplement a few hundred bucks a month. That'd be nice. So that's the roaming gnome part of where this all began. And then maybe not quite as suddenly as it began, but as eventually it petered out, they moved on to another campaign. They gave me a shot, try out for the new campaign, but I wasn't what they wanted. They went to female. And then the account left, and somewhere in, I think, Georgia agency has got it now. So that's the story of the Q-mobile. Okay, I see the other thing I have to talk about. I'll wait.
You become as low as my noise level, Bob. The WA4GK, and okay for everything about
tuning 20 meters. Band is in decent shape. I turned on some beeps. Oops. You can hear it beep now when I do that little SWR test. Ooh. beeps loud. I hope I remember to turn that down in post. I might see it on the timeline. The antenna's in good position. SWR is low. In the vicinity of the... you're seeing a police car up there. Maybe you're seeing him. He's just going over to check out that stuff. Not hearing any slow scan. Oh, there it is. Way in the background. I am just south of Fayetteville. It's not as far along as I thought. I might be able to get into that other DMR repeater. Is not overloaded. Okay, there's a good strong slow scan signal. And still the old analog slow scan. The digital stuff is so much nicer, or so it would seem, but people are hanging into the analog.
RCQ here from our Loma Linda Veterans Administration Hospital. It's the Jerry Pettis VA Hospital. You said you've been listening for a while, so you probably know what we've got going on here. I'd like to ask you if you're a military veteran, and if you served, what branch was it? Over.
So Loma Linda, I believe that's California. So 20 meters is in good shape here on the declining side of the sunspot cycle. But even at the bottom, it could do this time of day.
So the joint, we moved off. Appreciate that. Anyway, temperature here is 62 degrees. 62 degrees. It is beautiful here. It is mostly sunny, partly cloudy. The clouds are all high clouds, though.
Yeah, but it didn't hurt a thing. I tell you what that wind did, it bent my tower a little bit. I get to the back to the east looking, or the west looking.
Oh my.
And I can see ever so slight that it did move it or bend it. Just.
I don't know what you do for a bent tower. Hope for a wind to come along from the other direction. And I guess if it's bent sideways, you tighten up a guy wire or something.
CFD. Is that any better, Doug?
Got a lot of one-sided conversations due to propagation here. 20's evidently just long. If you're wondering what I'm talking about.
No, I don't really know the background on the gun. I have heard of it before. I presume it's a standard issue sniper rifle for the British.
20 meters has some skip zone all the time. Sometimes it can be really long. If we're here out to California, the average 20 meter contact, I would say you can hear both sides. But plenty of conversations where you can't because you're in a skip zone for one station.
That's just good.
And here we're in the skip zone for whoever I was talking to. But a few folks have tuned in. I'm only hearing one side. And that's a little unusual for 20 meters.
Comes back up, I'll give you
a call or something, okay?
Yeah. Still nothing. So I'm going to, well, first I'll see if I'm in this DMR repeater. Nope. The one I've got dialed in is in Dillon, South Carolina. On the other side of the, just on the other side of the state line. Changing zones. A zone is like a memory bank. This radio's got a channel switch on top, 16 channels. And those 16 channels make up one zone. So like a memory bank, then you can change zones and now you've got 16 different channels. KN4AQ Mobile, I-95, a little bit south of Fayetteville on Southern Pines PRN. I think it was KJ4UBU, KN4AQ. That sounds familiar. I think we have chatted recently. My name is Gary, southbound I-95 on the way toward Orlando, and just a 4-watt MD380HT, but an antenna up on the roof, and I'm wondering how I'm getting over into the Southern Pines repeater. See, maybe not. Maybe not so well. I didn't put in the echo test function for these repeaters. I knew I wasn't going to be in range of them very long, so I didn't want to fill up the zone, the 16 available channels with the extra functions. Turns out I could have, because I didn't use up all 16. It's 16 channels, but for a lot of repeaters, all 16 channels are the same repeater, and they are addressing different talk groups. DMR is a internet-based linking system-centric network, and you can have the repeater communicate through a lot of different talk groups, two at a time. And that's, you would think, well, one at a time, but they do have two time slots available because they divide the time division multiplex. They divide the time in, I think, about 36 millisecond increments. And that makes up two totally separate, distinct, and non-interfering conversations. Two different mobiles driving around the same town, talking on the same repeater at the same time. They don't hear each other. I mean, literally transmitting, both of them transmitting at the same time, having two separate conversations out through the network to other people, or even in town to people. The repeater tells the radios when to start and when to stop in those 36 millisecond chunks of transmission. Very carefully controlled.
WA9AOE, KT4V, Morehead City, PRN. Are you still around, Link?
Well, I'm hearing them fine, but they're not hearing me.
Okay,
Put that on standby. So am I out of things to talk about? How could that be? I think I've gone well over an hour, though, so... I guess I'm going to put the camera on standby and see what else comes up. Well, actually... Let's try this. KN4AQ mobile echo testing on Dylan D-Star. Yeah, nothing there. KN4AQ mobile echo testing on Dylan D-Star. I keyed it up. I saw it come back on the S-meter, but didn't echo me. KN4AQ mobile echo testing on Dylan D-Star. This is one of those wide coverage repeaters on a 2,000 foot tower, probably at the 1,500 foot level or so. KN4AQ mobile testing on Dylan. See if it's linked anywhere. Not indicating that it's linked. KN4AQ, mobile on I-95, a little bit south of Fayetteville, listening on Dylan Port C. Seems like it. I'm hearing it strong enough. It should be hearing me strong enough that I would have heard its echo, the echo function working, but I didn't. There was a UHF repeater associated with it that's not keying up. And that leads me to believe that they may have taken the UHF side off and replaced it with the DMR repeater, the Dylan DMR repeater's UHF. So go down to the zone again. Sooner or later, I'll be in range of it. But not now. No way to get over to the left lane, so I'll just do the slowdown thing. It is required in most states. And I don't know if you could feel the shuddering. You could hear the shuddering. I do need to get the brakes reworked. I was in for brake service, or at least to have them check it. 20,000 miles ago, and they said they're fine, and they've never been touched. Never had brakes redone in this car. That seems ridiculous, but so many of their miles are this kind of driving, which doesn't use very much of the brakes. And then when I am doing city driving, I tend to drive slow and not brake real hard. So evidently I'm good on brakes. Yeah, let's see. Just doing an analog scan through all the 2 meter channels. Hearing some linked repeaters over in the Southern Pines area. It's about 40, 50 miles away. And other than that, not very much on the radio. One of the things I like, you're not going to be able to see what I'm doing, I don't think. One of the things I like a lot about this Yaesu 8900 and their 7900, 8800, and 8900 series is these buttons, these buttons alongside the display that I can't even remember what they officially call them, but they basically take a snapshot of the radio, and with one button you can get to a lot of different settings at once. You can have it scanning and store that button, and when you push the button again it'll start scanning again. So it's very handy, and there's six of them, so I use a few of them when I'm for home. I just about never change. And then a couple on the bottom are designed for travel, so I can quickly toss something in. So I'm not very well set for programming for analog stuff. I know I didn't do any programming ahead. I spent all my time trying to program mostly DMR stuff. And a little bit of D-Star. As interesting as I was looking into South Carolina, I think that they are transitioning away from D-Star and into DMR for their MCOM stuff. Because some of the D-Star repeaters that I used to have are not on the list anymore. I don't know if they're still on the air or not, but they're not on the list. And we'll find out if they're there. The stuff along I-95. I didn't go look at the, this is the South Carolina Hartz, SC Hartz group. And most of their repeaters are linked through a statewide microwave network that's part of the television system, the state public television network. They're on those towers and they're on their microwaves. 30 miles to Pedro. So they may be sliding over to DMR. Not sure. They built an analog system and they overlaid it with a D-Star system, and now I don't know. All right, tell you what, I'm going to put things on standby here. I got a feeling the next thing you see is going to be from the top of the sombrero at Pedro's. There's clouds. We could, in 30 miles, we could have a thunderstorm. I don't know, we could. All right, see you in a little bit. Spin that special effect.
So darn. Had radios all set to go, measured distances, wanted to play handy-talkie on top of the tower, and it's closed. They said inside it's going to be closed for a few weeks, so it won't be open on the way back. So I'm disappointed. But I think I got the EPRS going.
I don't know if David's going to answer. See if I can get out into traffic. It is dribbling along, just too far apart to pull out. Ah, there he is. Hello, David. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Welcome to Ham Radio Now, episode 300.
Oh, excellent. I'm glad I could pop in for a little bit. You're on the road already?
Yeah. In fact, I don't know if you've ever heard of a place called Pedro's South of the Border.
I saw that on your last trip.
Well, I just tried to go up on the Sombrero and the elevator was closed. It's down for maintenance. Are we still connected? Oh, no. Something has failed.
Oh. Yeah, you're in and out.
Oh. Probably weak cell signal.
Yeah.
Now I'm getting on southbound 95. So I've talked for about, I don't know, an hour and a half with almost no radio activity, just blathering into the camera. And I thought, I better do something else. And now the Sombrero is a bitter disappointment. So just audio here. I don't have your video because on the low bandwidth mobile connection. But episode 300, woohoo!
Very good, very good. Well, you're recording on that end, and I'm not sending video anyways because I wasn't sure how you were going to pick up this call or not.
Yeah.
Everything's good on the drive so far.
Yeah, beautiful day. It's 70 degrees. We're no longer not a cloud in the sky, but not very many clouds. If you saw that episode on the road down to St. Petersburg, I wasn't able to go up on the Sombrero because there were thunderstorms coming. So I thought,
right.
You know, looking out on the horizon, and it was a gorgeous day. The wind is light. Everything should be wonderful. And now the elevator's out of service.
Oh, no.
And well, not like for a half hour, but for a couple of weeks.
Hopefully.
Uh-oh, no. I just went by a sign here that says, expect delays.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to expect delays, although Google Maps, I see where they're talking about. It's not much. No red. Pretty good shape.
I remember my time we lived back east. There were two seasons. There was winter and road repair. So we must be getting towards the road repair season.
Yeah. Well, you know, Florida should be great, but down here, we can have winter here.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good. Well, excellent. So nothing much on the low bands there on your drive so far.
Yesterday when I was setting things up and just testing the audio and stuff, I was tuning across 20 meters. And there was this huge signal, about the only signal on the band, and the guy identified Victor Kilo 3 something from Australia. I'd never heard an Australian signal that loud from the car, or probably from the house either. But he was in a conversation. He wasn't calling CQ, and he wasn't working pileups, so I couldn't work him. But I recorded it. The signal is recorded for posterity. It was awesome.
Very good. Very good.
Yeah. 20's open.
How many more hours you got to drive today?
Probably about 3. I'm going to probably make it to about Savannah, and then I'm going to try to edit this thing and get it online.
Okay. So 300 is going to be just the first day of the road trip. And then tomorrow you get all the way down to Orlando.
Yeah. That's only a few more hours. And, I get there in time to meet Jason and help him set up his booth and get equipment set up and figure out what we're going to do. Really haven't coordinated with him enough. A few emails back and forth saying, yeah, sounds like a great idea. Let's do something. But haven't. Well, let me take a careful look at the map. Yes, I'm still going south. I did not get back on the road going the wrong direction.
I remember that from last time.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. That's good news. I did see one or two emails back and forth that sounded like you found a good conference to record yesterday. And you said you had a short list of folks you wanted to see or potentially take for different ones of the talks.
Yeah, I haven't asked anybody yet, so it'll be last minute. I looked over their list of forums, and there were a few that Jason hadn't mentioned that I thought would be cool to do. So we'll see if he wants to do them with me or you know, what his plan is. I should give him a call and do some coordinating.
Right. Do you have any interviews lined up already?
No, I never do that in advance.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I never do anything in advance.
Just hit and run there.
Yeah. I never have time to set things up. I get what
right,
I get.
Right. Well, I'm working on setting some stuff up. I'll send you an email later on. Maybe you can take a look at it when you get to Savannah about coordinating episode 301 or 302.
Well, it's going to be a little farther down the road than that. But, but you know, hopefully by the end of next week or early the week after. I'm looking forward to hearing the folks that did the Women's March.
Right, and that's what I wanted to talk to you about, was coordinating just times when you think you'd be back in. Set up and available. I want to get them up for sure.
Yep. Expect that will be, I'll be back on Tuesday, maybe Wednesday, and the soonest I'd be able to actually do anything is over the weekend, because radios are making...
In the background there, it's hard to hear you.
Trying to figure out what radio's making noise. It's the... it was the APRS radio. And plugging everything in last night, I managed to unplug the APRS radio, so at least the stop at south of the border was good enough to get me back on APRS. In fact, if you've got APRS.fi and dial that in and look at KN4AQ-9, you'll probably see me. I think there's a beacon around here somewhere.
All right, let's pull that up before I get recorded for you.
I wish I was live on the internet now and people could go do that with you.
Well, I've got you here. Oh, yep, you just passed south of the border.
Ah, cool. It works.
And hard to tell which direction you're going. Up there you are. Yep, you're going south. It looks like you're going south and you're going west as well.
Yep. I'm going the right direction for once.
Oh, good. Well, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
That's a good thing. Okay, let me see. I can turn on traffic as well and see how the traffic works. Well, that's great. You're making progress. It looks like it got you, yeah, basically it looks like the APRS started at south of the border.
Yeah, it just, normally it would have tracked me most of the way through North Carolina, but I tried to turn it on and I was already driving, so the display was blank. Yeah.
I've had in LA there are a couple of internet gateways, but I have kind of spotty experience getting it listed up here. I get a lot of reports from folks driving along the way and can ping them back, but sometimes it works there better than I do.
APRS coverage is far from universal. There's lots of areas that don't have any coverage, and I kind of wonder in the areas that have a good digipeater and are busy, the number of people that are operating is really small, the percentage of people that are on the air, and yet the digipeater is making traffic all the time. I kind of wonder how much more loading those digipeters could take, how many more people could actually get on.
And
before things got hopelessly overloaded. Now they could be more cellular. The digipeater around home is at 1,200 feet. There could be 10 digipeaters at 100 feet and cover the same territory without all the overlap. There's
there
more.
Was somebody I heard.
Go ahead.
There was somebody I heard on a podcast recently. They were talking about, it may have been Emory or 360. They were talking about putting together Raspberry Pi ETS digipeaters that you can plug in and easily get an antenna splitter, you know, a 2-meter repeater up, and just throw that in on the line with a duplexer and add that in for almost no hit on the bandwidth and no effect at all on a 2-meter. You can't do it, of course, on a 70-centimeter repeater because you step on each other. Great to see more of that going on. I'm going to talk to the folks here when we finally get our Yaser repeater up and running that we've been working on. Because I think that's going to be a 2-meter repeater, and see if we can't add that functionality to it.
I'm not sure how you'd add APRS to a repeater, because, you know, the 1200...
Well, no, it's you're basically just adding it to the antenna. You're putting a splitter in, feeding the antenna, and you put a Raspberry Pi there if you got an internet connection, and there's got your radio along with it, so you're receiving that in and digipeating it on. But basically, most of the repeater antennas, they were saying, had the capability to do, you know, dual banding, you know, 70 centimeters and 2 meters. And if you already have that, it's a pretty cheap add to put the splitter on, and the Raspberry Pi is about $30 and some junk radio like sitting around that'll do light duty to be able to add more gateways.
Yeah, if your antenna is dual band and you're just using it on 440, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that combination is probably kind of rare. And with enough plumbing, you could do it on a 2-meter repeater. You could just add enough cavities to split off that frequency, especially if the repeater were up in the top above 147 megahertz. Your insertion loss would add a couple of dB of loss to the whole system, but it could be done and probably is being done because antenna space up high is hard to come by.
Right. Absolutely, absolutely.
DMR just came to life.
What are you listening to on the low bands?
Right now it's turned off.
Oh, it's turned off. Okay.
Turn it back on. I think that I was on 17 meters. Yeah, it's on 17 meters.
Yeah.
Which was kind of open. Although, the antenna.
Well, I was thinking. I could get about 5 more minutes, and I got to go off to a meeting. But I was thinking I could. I could self-spot you on the Facebook group, at least. See if I can get some traffic going.
That would end up with me listening on one place for a long time and then probably nobody calling me. So, it's an interesting idea. I've done that myself. I spotted myself onto Facebook. And after a half hour, it attracted one or two people saying, I'm listening. But I was long gone by then.
Gotcha.
So I need to become, you know, a much bigger shot. You know, that's about to happen anytime now. We're going to break through.
Anytime. That's right. You're more than your 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, good, Wayne. What are you hoping to see down there specifically?
I don't know.
Anything you read about that you really want to see?
Well, the thing I'd really like to see is the DV4 mobile, the multi-mode. You know, we're changing the definition of the word multi-mode. Until recently, the multi-mode meant your HF transceiver would do sideband, CW, maybe RIDI or some data mode, and FM on 10 meters. That was multi-mode. That doesn't cut it anymore. Multi-mode is now D-Star, Fusion, DMR, P25, and let's see, Uli was saying that the DV4 mobile will have its own proprietary, but its own unique digital mode, and it will be able to operate as a TDMA repeater, and on four frequencies at once or something like that, or four voice channels at once. And David Rowe has also been building something that would operate as a TDMA repeater using codec 2. So the future is going to get very complicated for multi-mode.
Mm-hmm. Sure will. Can you get one?
I don't think I'll get one yet. I don't think I want serial number 1. I think I'm going to let them work the bugs out. So,
yeah, version 2.0 then, huh?
Yeah. So that might, the other thing I might look for is one of the DMR mobiles, maybe a Connect Systems or something, so I've got an official mobile. We'll see.
You had a good time when you were skiing with the DMR, the TYT radio.
Yeah, but we weren't using it DMR. It was just analog.
Oh, okay.
I was listening to a... the trunk system that is operated by the resort. It's got the ski patrol on it. It's got the everybody, the ski school, the lift operators, the folks on the mountain, the mountain guides and help and stuff. So all of that is kind of merged together when you're listening on an analog receiver that can't do the trunk tracking. But none of it was busy enough that it was a real pain. Normally I'd hear entire conversations or enough of them that I got what I was listening for. It was all hit and miss. And also discovered that with a system like that, they always go to the first one designated repeater for the first use, and they only bring up the other repeaters if the first one's already in use. And so scanning was kind of useless. So I just fixed it on that one frequency and heard what I heard. It was really useful on the first day as we were driving in. We heard how many lifts were going down because of the high wind. So we realized we still went to ski, foolishly. But, we were there. So we only got 5 or 6 runs in. It was real high wind and very cold and snowing hard. So, it was semi-miserable. But at least we knew going in that it was going to be miserable. It wasn't a big surprise.
You knew it would be that way. Yeah. Didn't have to wait and buy your lift tickets a day later.
Couldn't do that. Already bought them for a five day pass, and we're going to be there 5 days. So it would have been cheaper to buy just 4 because of the deal you get when you buy 5. So
right. Yeah. So you were locked in anyway.
More like a free day.
All right. Well, good. You made use of them then.
Yeah. Yeah. TMR is making some noise. So there's been a DMR repeater that thought I should have been a range in, but I'm not keying it up at all. But the next one down the road, I'm coming into range of. So I guess I'll go play DMR a little bit.
That's the HD?
Yeah. But it's connected. It's on life support. It's connected to the outside antenna to power speaker mic. So, but yeah. I don't have it plugged into the audio system. So I just pulled the microphone up.
It's coming through. I can't understand it all the way. There's a good draw there, but hear it.
Yeah, you're not hearing me through my audio system. You're just hearing me through the microphone that's sitting on the phone. So you're getting bad audio and lots of background noise.
And are you piping me in so you're getting a good recording of me?
Right. The speaker side, the audio side from the phone is going into the audio system. So,
gotcha.
Yep.
Gotcha.
You're a little muddy, but okay. I'll do a little equalization on that part.
Yeah, and that's I'm on my cell coming through, and I don't have a good speaker here or a good microphone here.
Yeah. Actually, it sounds it is missing highs, yeah. but it's not bad.
Well, it's missing highs because I have a cold.
Oh. Sorry about that. Stop shaking hands.
Yeah, there you go.
And stop having kids.
Well, we're done with that.
Well, I mean, not having new ones, just having any at all.
Oh, well, yeah, I'm going to keep it for a little while.
Yeah.
All right, Gary, I got to run off to something, but thanks for including me in the episode. I appreciate you calling me in, and hopefully you have safe travels.
Thank you.
And I'll send you a note about scheduling the Women's March thing. And before I go, if you want, I can spot you, or just tell everybody that you're on the road. If they're in the area, they should be.
Tell them to look for me on APRS.fi.
Okay, very good. I will do that.
Now that I'm here.
Okay, safe travels, Gary.
Here comes my backup. Thanks, David. Bye bye.
All right, 73 from W0DH.
Okay, not the backup. Not the backup I was expecting, and there we go. Now we're hung up. Back to... Google Maps, keep an eye on what's going on. Let's see what the deal was with this DMR system. The repeater in Dillon seemed to be off the air. The next repeater down the road is only about 30 miles down the road. That's Florence. This is KN4AQ Mobile, southbound 95, heading toward Orlando, right now going through the Florence PRN repeater. I'm not popular on PRN. So let me talk a little bit about the programming I was doing on this DMR system. When I was going down to St. Petersburg, I had just gotten my feet wet in DMR. I didn't really know a lot about it. I was getting an understanding of how it worked, but what I was baffled with was all of the available talk groups. And again, I want to do a program where I just dig in pretty deeply on programming this radio. And also, I'm not an expert by any means yet, but I know a whole lot more than I used to. So I came to the conclusion that living in North Carolina, North, South Carolina, good pieces of Virginia, West Virginia, most of the DMR repeaters are associated with a network called PRN. And I've learned that PRN stands for Private Repeater Network, which means the network doesn't own the repeaters. I guess that's what that means, that each repeater on it is a private repeater. They just joined this loose consortium of repeaters that gets together, and the common piece would be the servers that tie things together and take you out to the internet and off to the other. Okay, so maybe we'll hit the backup here. I don't think there'll be a big backup. We're losing a lane, so everybody's slowing down a little bit, but it's not coming to a standstill. It's not even showing up as yellow on Google Maps. At least not yet. So PRN keeps things fairly tight. The DMR system has two time slots, again with the alternating time division, 36, I think, milliseconds for one conversation, next 36 milliseconds for the other conversation, going back and forth. And I've had some interesting artifacts with that. By having a couple of handy talkies and listening and keying things up, I can hear the transmitter burp on and off in that really fast rate. It hits some speakers around home that normally, if you would key up a radio, there might be a little pop out of the speaker, but now the transmitter is going on and off real fast, so the speaker motorboats. It's, you know, too RF sensitive. And then I've gone listening for what things sound like on an analog receiver, and you hear the same thing. You hear the signal come and go real fast. You also hear what it sounds like when you're trying to make a connection to a repeater, your first transmission, and the repeater's not hearing you, or there's no repeater. The radio goes blip, 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 sends out tiny bursts of data waiting for something to come back from the repeater. If something does come back from the repeater, sends you a tone, and you're on and making your transmission. If nothing ever does, then eventually the radio goes burp and says, no talk for you. Okay, we are slowing down here. Not sure why. Because everybody's in this lane now. We should be able to just go, but we're not. So PRN dedicates one of those time slots to the network that all the repeaters in North, or most of the repeaters in North and South Carolina, Virginia, West Virginia, and a few in the peripheral states. They just sit on that all the time. The second time slot is available for whatever connection you want to make. And there's, in PRN territory, there's maybe a half a dozen or so they call them talk groups. And you on your local repeater, you kerchunk your radio. One of your memories is set for each of those potential talk groups. You switch to that memory, you kerchunk your radio, and that takes the other time slot of the repeater and connects it to that talk group for as long as you maintain activity on it. Most of them will time out in 10 or 15 minutes if no local transmission has been made. And that time slot will stay quiet until you either have a local conversation going on the repeater or someone ties it to a talk group. So one talk group available for whatever connections you want to make. The other talk group, you can't do anything but use it for the PRN network. Get out of PRN territory and things change. And so I'm looking at the repeaters in Georgia, and it doesn't appear to be much DMR along I-95 in Georgia. I think there's one just on the Florida border. There might be one more. I don't think there was anything in Savannah. So not much, at least that I could find. Now, the record keeping is not very good. There are maps and lists all over the place, and they're not accurate. They're not up to date. People have been complaining about that. That's pretty much like any repeater system and any listing of repeater systems. Somebody gets all excited, and they list everything that they can figure out that's going on, and then that website sits there for months or years, and things change on the air, and nothing changes on the website. So that's what I'm doing. I'm looking to see what possibilities there are, and there's several. There's one in Kingsfield, I think it was, that's it's in Georgia, but it's basically part of the Jacksonville, Florida metropolitan area. And it's tied into a group called First Coast, which is the northeast Florida area. And there's several more around the Jacksonville area. So I'm working on programming those in. And the details of programming for DMR I'm going to save for this program I'm theoretically going to make sometime. But there's a fair amount of detail to get things programmed. And then I go deeper into this First Coast thing, and I come across this page that says, "We've changed. We've gone Brandmeister." And everything I'd programmed in was not Brandmeister. It was a list from somebody else, someplace else, and it was obsolete. So now I throw all that away, and I start over, and now I program in the stuff that I'm now assuming is up-to-date and accurate, but there's still no way to know for sure. There wasn't a date on the information. I don't think there was. So, again, the First Coast guys, I wasn't looking at their website before. I was looking at somebody else's. Till I got to the First Coast website, I didn't even know all these repeaters were part of First Coast. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt that their information is up to date and accurate. And so I got all that programmed in. And then by the time I got that done, it was like 11 o'clock last night, and I had to get up this morning early and get on the road. So my programming stops at Jacksonville, and now I want to get stuff in Orlando programmed. There's probably some simplex I'll be able to discover that people will be using around the area. I'm sure there's some repeaters, might even be some temporary repeaters set up. And since you can't program DMR stuff very easily from you can't program it all from the radio I've got. You can program it from some radios. It'll be set it up on the computer best I can and get what you get. I was watching the programs that Jason Johnston, KC5HWB, did on Ham Radio 2.0 on the radio that the R-Finder guys, Bob Greenberg, is putting out. They've got a Chinese radio. It's really an Android phone with a UHF radio attached, and then they've done some of their own firmware and software, and they put DMR in it. And he's talking about putting other modes in it, but right now it's analog and DMR. It's a big clunky thing, but I'm probably going to get a chance to see one. Jason will probably bring his, and he'll be there. And it will let you pick data out of the RFinder website and automatically populate your radio. And since it's an Android radio, in theory, you can have it subscribed to a phone service and get internet service. And that's coming closer to my goal, you know, being able to punch a button on a radio and have it figure out what's going on. All these radios that I'm looking at here, they're getting old. All the programming is by computer. Some of the computer, the software, is able to look out on the internet and come up with something of a list, either connected to RFinder or connected to repeater book, and put in a list that I can set up a route and it would show the repeaters along the route. All those lists need a fair amount of massaging to actually put something useful into the radio. So you pull the list down, then you got to tweak it a lot. Still takes a lot of time. We're beginning to see radios that this happens with D-Star, and now it's going to happen with DMR with this one radio. And I'm not sure what capabilities they've got on the Yaesu Fusion side of things, but the radio will have a GPS, and you give it an internet connection. They don't have a built-in one. I guess you give it an internet connection, or maybe you program it with a card or something. But in any case, it's also getting closer to tell the radio where you are, and it will go pull data from a database and populate the radio. Now, for analog anyway, the databases are crap. They're riddled with errors, even the good ones. RFinder and repeater books still have way too many errors. I'm going to guesstimate 30 to 40% of the information is bad. Different in different areas. Some areas are really bad, some areas are a lot better. And it all depends on how energetic the frequency coordinator, repeater council, and individual repeater owners are in keeping things up to date, and how many of them aren't trying to hoard a frequency that they haven't actually been using for a long time, but don't want to give up the coordination because they don't think they'll ever get coordination again if some other repeater comes on it because things are full. So that's where things stand in terms of trying to populate radios with database information on repeaters. So anyway, that's the holy grail. It'll be nicer, but none of these radios are ever going to do anything like that. The closest will come is software that can set up a file to program the radio from a better source. Something that you say where you're going, and the information that it gives you back is pretty clean. I never expect perfection, but looking for something to be pretty clean. We'll see. And when I don't know, Bob Greenberg is going to be at Orlando. That's where I first talked to him, I've done three interviews with him. Only one has ever made it online. Sorry, Bob. We'll try harder. Talked to him last Dayton. Haven't gotten that online. There was some interesting information there, but nothing earth-shaking, and he hadn't got any of the DMR stuff going at that point. So now it's kind of getting obsolete. So he very well could be there and showing off the radio, and maybe we'll talk about this stuff. And he may say, Gary, I'm not going to talk to you anymore until you actually put a conversation online. We'll see. I'm sorry, Bob. So, meanwhile, back in DMR land, let me put the radio in scan. I figured out how to make the radio scan. So when I put it in scan, it's going to look at a whole lot of talk groups, if any of them are active locally. So that's when I was talking about Florida, the thing that I couldn't figure out was that they listed a lot of talk groups, and the information on, is this talk group on the repeater full time? Is it push to talk, you know, dial up? Is it, you know, access on demand? You could tell what time slots they were going to be on, but it lacked clear explanation. It's one of those things that if you've been there a while and you know the local system, then it all makes sense. And all of the explanation has to be done for newbies, folks just getting started, folks traveling through the area. I'm going to say DMR is even more traveler hostile than ordinary FM analog repeaters are. Analog repeaters or travel are hostile because of subaudible tone. Most repeaters these days, more than half, require subaudible tone. Figuring out what that tone is very difficult. The radios are not manufactured to help. If the repeater's on the air, most of the radios have some form of tone scan. Some implement it fairly well, some implement it very poorly. By well, for example, it's easy to get to a button push or two, and when it's scanning, it doesn't turn off the speaker. Poorly implemented, you gotta go through menus, and once it starts to scan, it shuts off the speaker until it arrives at the tone, and then opens the speaker. And you miss everything that's going on until it finds the tone. Or if it never finds the tone, you never hear anything. That's what I call poorly implemented. So some radios do something well, fairly well, and some don't. What I want to see is a radio that does subaudible tone, where you dial in a repeater, the radio's got a little, not a, a tone scanner in it, it's got a little audio a frequency counter. It rapidly, this radio has that. When it lands on a repeater that's busy, that's sending tone, it very quickly displays what that tone is on its display. It's not scanning for the tone. It's got a frequency counter. So all these radios could be able to do that. Land on a repeater, it's got a tone, frequency counter figures out the tone, plugs it in, turns it on, all without operator intervention. And the only problem with that is that it then requires the repeater to be on the air before you know about it. If it's not on the air, if it's not a busy repeater, then you're going to drive on by and never even know. Unless you can program everything in advance. Yeah, I'm beaconing. And it heard me. Something, the radio, the D710 will beep back at me if it hears its beacon repeated by a digipeater, and that's what it just did. So anybody looking on APRS.fi for KN4AQ-9, you'll know that I am on I-95 going by the exit for Florence. And getting to be, well, it's way past real lunchtime, but it's getting to be my lunchtime. Not that starving. I may just wait for dinner. We'll see. So I guess I should turn on a radio again here. Ow. So I'm hearing a little voice way in the background. I'm wondering if that's Hawaii. I'll wait till the next minute. That would be cool. We've heard that before. Coming up on it, listen for the weak voice in the background, because the Hawaii voice gives the time earlier. Yeah, it's Hawaii. So you probably hear the female voice was Hawaii, and it came just before the male voice from Fort Collins. So cool.
See if anybody's playing on 20 meters. We know the band is open. I'm looking for strong signals. Oh, no. Let me double check my antenna. Oh, it's way off. This controller can lose count. And it says you're set up for a specific band, but and the antenna is not very broadband. You know, on 20 meters, it's fairly broadband. Get a megahertz off, though, and it's out of SWR spec for where you'd want it to be. There we go. That's better. I remembered to turn the beep thing down. You can thank me now. There's a good ham, and he may be standing by to call CQ, or maybe CQDX, or maybe start a net.
Hello, CQ, calling CQ, K0EEA, calling. Kilo 10 Echo Alpha, calling and standing by.
K0EEA, Kilo November 4, Alpha Quebec, Mobile in South Carolina.
Yeah, KN4AQ. KN4AQ. This is K0EEA, returning.
Score.
Thank you very much for the call. My name is D-I-C-K, dog item Charlie King. And the QTH here is Clearwater, Kansas. Clearwater, Kansas. So, now copy KN4AQ, Mobile, K0EEA.
Okay, Dick. Loud and clear, your signal's about S5, so I'll give you a 5x5, but no trouble copying, and good on Clearwater. I thought you were going to say Clearwater, Florida, and that would have surprised me a little bit because I'm not that far from it. I'm heading for the Orlando HamCation, southbound on Interstate 95 right now, and kind of the middle of South Carolina. Be in Georgia in an hour or so. My name is Gary, G-A-R-Y, Gary. Home is in the Raleigh, North Carolina area, and don't know if the Orlando HamCation has a profile, if it's up on the radar screens as far west as Kansas. It's a big ham fest, but not quite like Dayton, so I don't know. Do you guys know about Orlando over there?
Well, I've heard people talking about it, but I've never been there, so not familiar with it. Anyway, yeah, very good. And good to hook up with you there. You got a nice signal coming in here really good this afternoon. And the band isn't all that active either. So you're doing quite well. We're just running 100 watts here with a ICOM 7300. Running it barefoot here into a little ground-mounted gap vertical, ground-mounted gap vertical here for 20 meters. So anyway, that's what we have on this end. We're in a antenna-restricted type area, so can't put up a big arrays or anything like that. So anyway, that's what we got going here. It's a cold day here today. Compared to yesterday, we was close to 70 degrees yesterday, and today it's right at the freezing mark, or just a little above freezing. So quite a contrast from yesterday's weather. KN4AQ Mobile, K0EEA.
Yeah, that is a body-shaking departure, KN4AQ Mobile. It is 72 degrees here. Clouds are starting to build up. It's been real bright and sunny all day, but I'm heading into real 5 thin overcast and then some scattered puffy cumulus down below it. And it's going to be a gorgeous weekend according to the weather forecast for the HamFest. Orlando's the second biggest HamFest and probably way ahead of whoever's number 3. Their annual attendance is in the 12,000 to 13,000 range. Dayton is in the 25,000 range. And then there's a handful of regional HamFests that hit the 5 or 6, 7,000 range. So I think Orlando is clearly ahead of whoever's in third place. But it draws from the eastern part of the country quite a bit. People will travel a good distance to go there. Of course, it's right next to Disney World and a lot of attractions in that area, so good for families. You know, dad, unfortunately, ham radio is mostly dad, can come on down for the weekend, and then the family can go over to see the Mouse or Universal or Harry Potter, and maybe you can join them. That's not too far. It's about a couple-hour drive from the Space Coast. Head on over to see Cape Canaveral, and I've done that. So a lot to bring you down to that area, and of course a lot of retired people, so it's quite a draw, and they have a huge RV section as well. So good on the station. When I'm operating mobile, most of the folks I talk to will be running high power and big antennas, so it's good to talk to somebody that's at my level. My home station's same thing, 100 watts. It's a dipole. And I'm lucky to have that and no opportunity to put up anything bigger. And here in the car, I'm running the ICOM 7000, so it's also 100 watts. And the antenna's a Tar Heel Model 200 screwdriver, full-size, great big honking antenna sitting on the back of the car. Let's see if we're holding up. Back to you, Dick. KN4AQ Mobile, southbound Interstate 95.
Yeah, very good, Gary. Yeah, you're still coming in great. Very good signal here this afternoon. No problem at all.
Maybe S9.
Copying you there with the 7000. That's a good little radio. We have used. We had one of them at one time when we operated Mobile, and but since we've got out of the Mobile operation, but. We did have one of the 7000s, and like I say, it's a good radio. The menu system is a little bit hard to maneuver, but once you get everything set up, it performs quite well. And we had a little auto tuner along with it there too, and it worked real good for us there. We just used the Hustler antennas there as what we used with it there, and worked quite well. So anyway, that's the story, and that's the situation there. And we do have a Carolina Windham up on the roof of the house, which just kind of strung between three peaks up there, just kind of stealthing it up there on the roof. It's not laying on the roof, but it's pretty hard to see. And so we just put this little ground-mounted vertical for 20 out here, kind of alongside the house here. It's not too conspicuous there. So anyway, that's what we've been using, and seems to work fairly well for us there. Well, Gary, we'll kick it back your way, and I assume that HamFest probably all weekend probably starts Friday, I assume, and lasts through Sunday there. KN4AQ, K0EEA.
Okay, your signal got stronger. You're at least S7 and maybe a few hits up at S9. And if you're familiar with the 7000's S-meter, I don't have a preamp on, so it is not a generous S-meter. It's not terrible, but if you're S9, you're a strong signal, and rarely do you see anything much above that. The HamFest used to run starting at noon on Friday and then all day Saturday and then until noon on Sunday, noon or 1 o'clock. Last year, it was the ARL National Convention, and unfortunately, I got the flu just before. I felt fine that weekend, but I lost my travel days, so I didn't get there. It was the ARL National Convention, and because of that, they opened at 9 o'clock on Friday. So they were open all day Friday and Saturday, like Dayton. And I noticed this year they're opening at 9 o'clock again. So, and reports from the folks that were there last year said that attendance was good. It was crowded at opening bell on Friday morning. Well, after, you know, 30 minutes to let people in. You know, by 10 o'clock or so, aisles were pretty crowded. Don't know if you've ever been to Dayton. Dayton's certainly like that on Friday. Dayton's Friday attendance is better than every other HamFest's Saturday or Sunday attendance. So everybody would like to, in fact, everybody would like to have Dayton Sunday. Dayton Sunday is still pretty good, although the flea market is pretty well emptied out, but inside it's still very busy. And even at Orlando, by Sunday, things are getting quieter. You can walk down the aisles without having to jostle elbows with people. But it's still pretty good. And we'll see what it's like this year. It could be getting even better. Or maybe Friday will bleed a little bit of Sunday activity off. I don't know. A few other somewhat local ham fests have been experimenting because their Sundays were so dead. They decided to try being a Friday afternoon Saturday. And the results are mixed. One of them in Charlotte, North Carolina, is pretty quiet on Friday, but it's busier than their Sunday was, and their Saturday is staying pretty busy. So they've improved. They haven't gotten gangbusters, but they're doing better for having switched to a Friday Saturday. So let's see if we're holding up. Wonder if you've got a big ham fest that you go to somewhere out in the Midwest. K0EEA, KN4AQ Mobile.
Yeah, okay, Gary, you know, there's another station just off the side now, kind of caused a little interference there, but other than that, still copying you and good.
I want HF channelization.
We really don't have a whole lot around here. There's, of course, we're in southern Kansas here, close to Wichita is where we're at. And there's some down in Oklahoma, down around Ponca City and down in through there. Once a year, you know, smaller type of situation. But they're mainly, I think, I went to one once, and it was more of a flea market type thing. Very, very little new type of stuff, you know. Two vendors there with a few things, but very little, you know, there wasn't any new radios at all, big radios, antennas, and, you know, all that kind of stuff, connectors and such as that. But it just didn't really pull my chime any. So I haven't went back. So we're not in a very good area. You'd think they would have something kind of in the Midwest here, in the middle of the United States, to have a pretty good draw, but there just hasn't been anything that has been anything close to what you're talking about there. So anyway, so be it. We'd probably just have to buy something anyway if we did go to something like that. But type person, if I want something, I'll get online and find who has the best deal and go ahead and order it out. But anyway, that's kind of, it would be kind of nice to see some of that kind of stuff, you know, once in a while. I've kind of got an interest in SDR type equipment now, and I'm kind of getting antsy to get to try a little flex radio or something. I might try and find one used just to give it a try. And I've got a little SDR play module that I've been playing with. Of course, that's just a receiver. And that has really been kind of neat. And so that's got my interest peaked for the SDR type equipment. So I think we'll start seeing more and more of that as we go along as well. Anyway, sure good to hook up there, Gary. I wonder where you're planning on making it to this evening. Are you going? You going to be keeping on the road there, or what's your plans there for the evening? KN4AQ Mobile, K0EEA.
K0EEA, KM4AQ, you held up real well. A little bit of a fade here and there, but never below the S5 and often in the S7 or so range. So good and strong. And I didn't hear anybody off to the side. This is a private channel from this side so far. And I've often thought, wouldn't it be nice to have a channelized HF so that no one ever gets any closer than 2.5 or 3 kilohertz? I'd like to see 3. No one would do that. They do 2.5, but that would be better than what we get where somebody slides up a kilohertz and a half from you, and you start getting the but you can't do that. We're never going to do that. Don't worry. Don't send me email. No one's going to do that. And you asked me a question, and now I'm trying to remember what it was. But I was thinking, I thought you said you were running the ICOM 7300, did I remember that correctly, or are you running the 7100?
No, it's the 73. It's the 7300.
So isn't that ICOM's new software-defined radio?
Yeah, it is. It is. And I didn't get the software with it. About $100 item. And the reviews that I've seen on it, people got it, are not happy with it. It just doesn't do very good. So I'm kind of waiting for some improvements along that line. Go ahead.
Okay, but the radio inside is all still software-defined. All the filters and demodulation and all that stuff is still done in software. And I think we're probably not too far away, you know, a few years, because ham radio moves slower than the rest of technology in many areas, but not too far away from the point where software defined is going to be assumed in anything above a QRP kit. And even some of those will be. And it won't really be a selling point, because it's just the way to go, and every radio will have it. So then there'll be software wars. Oh, our DSP, our software defined, is better. Now we fine-tune our algorithms. I think right now, and I think where you're going at is, this software defined means the computer display control, which is, you know, certainly what Flex has done. Although I think that they're having great success with the Maestro control panel and getting away from the computer display, and they're attracting a lot of hams who were turned off by the computer display. So you can do both, but in, you know, the guts, and, yeah, Elocraft has been software defined inside, and they've never done serious display stuff. They do pan adapters and stuff like that, but general rig control has just been the knobs, the way, you know, conventional people like to do them. But it's still been software defined. It's not direct conversion. They still do a couple of steps of analog conversion, but their demodulation and stuff is all software defined. So, yeah, I think not too far away from the point where all the radios are, and no one can say, wow, we're software defined. Back to you, Dick, KN4AQ.
Okay. Yeah, very good. I'll be interested to know, Gary, if ICOM has the new 7610 there at that convention there. Supposedly that's getting real close to being ready to go. I guess it's actually pretty much ready to go now, but still waiting on some approvals, I think, and such as that. But I was just wondering if they ICOM might have one there on display to kind of get people really interested in. That sounds like that's going to be quite a radio there, but price, I think, is going to be fairly, it's going to be probably about twice what the 7300 is, I would imagine. But anyway, that'll be interesting to see how that all comes out there in the wash. So once they get going with that, then I'm sure all the others will be shortly following with their introductions there too. So it'll be interesting to see how it goes. But anyway, I've kind of got an interest in it there.
Have you noticed we're talking about radio? That's what hams do.
Hoping that I could hook this up to the computer there and do some things with it there. But I've got, we've got that little SDR play. Boy, he just gun that display there to get the signals all spread out and see the band at a glance as to what it's doing. And you want to click on a signal, you just move your mouse over there and click on it, and there it is. And you can certainly see the spacing of all the signals, and all is kind of neat. Of course, this little display that's on the 7300 is not too bad.
I also have a Yaesu FTDX 3000, and the scope in it is nothing compared to the 7300. So, but anyway, it's interesting, and see how it goes. But it's been a good little radio. I've had it, about 3 months, I guess, now. And it's been been fun to play with. We've got good reports and everything with it, so. It's been a fun little radio to play with. Well, that's about the size of it from here, Gary. I certainly enjoyed meeting you here. And certainly wish you well on your travels there. That one question I had for you is where you were planning on stopping for the night, or are you planning on keeping on going, or what? There was another question I had for you then. Back to you, KN4AQ, Mobile, K0EEA.
Okay, Dick, KN4AQ Mobile, held up good. Still a private channel. A little bit of noise. Picked up local noise sources a little bit here and there, but never lost you at all. I think I'm going to stop at Savannah, Georgia, just across the South Carolina-Georgia line. It looks like it's about 3 hours ahead. It's 3 o'clock here, so that'd be about 6 o'clock. That's about as far as I want to go. I've got some video to edit. I'm actually recording a program right now as we speak. You're going to be a television star. If you go to my QRZ page, you'll see what that's all about. I can't really talk about it because it's a business, but I will tell you this much. You'll be a television star, perhaps as soon as tomorrow. And that 7610 should be there. ICOM will have a large booth. This is the kind of HamFest where all the main manufacturers, all of them, and a lot of the smaller time folks will be there. And ICOM, Kenwood, Yaesu, Flex, Elecraft, they'll all have big booths, professional displays, not just radios sitting on tables. Not as big as they do at Dayton, but bigger than they do just about any place else. And if they've got a prototype to show, even if they can't turn it on and make it play, they'll have it sitting on the table or under glass or something. So, yeah, I'd expect it'll be there. And, yeah, it's been a pleasure talking to you. I will say 73, and who knows? We might speak again sometime. Back to you, Dick, for one final, and I'll be clear. KN4AQ Mobile, southbound I-95 in South Carolina.
Okay, yeah, very good. It's been my pleasure meeting you here. Go to your QRZ page there and see what that was all about you was talking about, so that'll be interesting. So it's been my pleasure meeting you here this afternoon. Again, safe travels to you there as you go to Savannah there. We spent about a week in Savannah there in Georgia. And I was in the Air National Guard. That was one of our summer camp encampments there. So, anyway, very good day to you there. Certainly wish you the best. KN4AQ, Mobile, K0EEA, Clearwater, Kansas, now signing clear.
73, Dick, KN4AQ, Mobile. That was interesting. A little whisper or something. That wasn't whisper. Maybe Olivia. Who knows? One of those FOMO digital modes that I can't copy and don't want anybody using because I can't copy it. All right, so you had a good long conversation, a fun guy to talk to. And I'm sure past the two-hour point, I got My co-host, David Goldenberg, in there for episode 300. I think there we go, 142 miles to Savannah. I think I'm going to wrap this up. I reserve the right to turn the camera back on and record something else if something pops up. Nothing's popping up on DMR. Maybe out of range of the Florence repeater. I don't know. We'll see. I'll play with those things. And again, if something pops up and I feel the need to bring the camera back on, I will do that. And I'll give myself an editing moment. And one brief editorial insert. I think it may be getting dark enough you can actually see the display. This is a D-Star repeater in... Okay, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say Beaufort.
It's not real difficult, but... It's kind of lit up right there, but I've got everything working.
Beaufort, South Carolina. There's a... Yes, town in North Carolina and South Carolina spelled the same way. In North Carolina, I believe it's pronounced Beaufort, and in South Carolina, it's Beaufort, and I may have that reversed.
Kenwood Booth. I'm the tall, right-wing one. Kevin's the smart, good-looking guy, and there's Bill.
What I'm particularly interested in is this is a very weak signal. This would be pretty noisy and analog.
Okay, real time. Brian, Frank, good to talk with you. You can also track me on that APRS, so if you go to APRS.fi, APRS.fi, you can put my call sign in, WCTPF.
Talk about APRS.fi.
Track me in real time, and I'll get you started in APRS.
It's not 100% rock solid. I'm getting closer to it.
I got it. I'm on the site, and I will give it a try.
I don't think I could get into the repeater from here.
I'll be here for the next 6 or 7 hours, so you can chime in there.
You can hear the errors, the bit errors, garbling a little bit. Oh, that I think that's Don Arnold, W6GPS.
I'll be monitoring. Have a safe ride here, and I got you up on the APRS.
Okay, real fine. All right, I'll be riding along here now, chit chat with Kevin, so just checking in every now and then, W6GPS.
Copy that. Kilo Mike 4 is to Robert Tango, clear and monitor.
Actually, I'm kind of surprised that I was hearing as many errors as I was with the signal that was more than one bar of strength. Because usually it's pretty good, pretty solid all the way down to almost no signal on the meter at all.
Okay, 4CS. 4CS, this is HR5 BBD. Good afternoon. Thanks for your call. It's nice to meet you. My name is Ivan. Remember, Ivan. And the KTH is Ulsan City, located in the southeast corner of Korean Peninsula. It's about 200 miles southeast of Seoul. Okay, how do you copy it back to you? This is HR5 BBD.
Frank, I'm over here in Trinity, Florida, where it's nice and warm. You're coming in loud and clear.
So it must be Reflector 30 or Reflector 1, one of those brings in people from around the world. Okay, well, that's what I wanted to show.
Enjoying the winter because tomorrow they're predicting snow, sleet, and probably locusts. Hi.
I don't know where he is.
Virginia is the only place I know where you can get sunburn and frostbite in the same week, over.
Yeah, okay. Don't ever say that. I mean, what he almost said was, if you don't like the weather, wait 5 minutes, it'll change. And people say that about every place they are. It's such a cliche. Anyway, getting closer to Beaufort. South Carolina.
DTR 5 with EBD.
Picking up a little rain on the windshield, too.
I don't know. It's, it's what I should think.
It wasn't supposed to be raining.
Could you come again? This is HR 5 Bravo from Delta Mobile.
All right, and now our regularly scheduled program close. Before I say, Arvin, Starvin Arvin, amradionow.tv. If you got to this point, you're enjoying this. So if you've got a little spare change here, wait till the end of the month, rattling around, don't know what to do with it, not going to buy a new 7300, stop by hamradionow.tv. Click on Starvin Arvin. I got to put that on the website, Starvin Arvin. That'll be good. And feed the pig. Remember, there's a bacon shortage, so we need to... That's fake news. The bacon shortage is fake news. but I did see that. So stop. Shut up. Time to go. 73. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.